we're not going to take seriously the antibiotic problem until things that many people can't even imagine start happening. Women dying 2 to 3 weeks after childbirth from infection, children dying from standard playground cuts. And why we're going into this sort of next or new dark age of antibiotics is because of superbugs. These are bacteria that do not respond to the clinical antibiotics we have.
According to the CDC, 1 out of every 3 antibiotics prescribed today is unnecessary. And all of that unneeded use might cause us to lose the most powerful tool we have to fight life-threatening infections.
And that's a scary thought. A century ago, before modern antibiotics, my hospital shifts would have looked so much different. For example, a bacterial infection as common as strep throat could have been a death sentence.
And what little treatment was available was often ineffective or even toxic. I mean, nurses were treating syphilis with mercury.
When antibiotics became widely available in the 1940s, human health was forever changed, adding 23 more years to our lifespan over time.
But today, overuse and misuse of antibiotics are causing bacteria to rapidly develop resistance to antibiotics. Superbug infections already kill 700,000 people a year. And by the year 2050, that number could reach 10 million.
So where are these superbugs coming from? And does the medical community have a backup plan for if and when antibiotics fail? Let's dive in.
My patients ask for Z-Packs, amoxicillin, and other antibiotics all the time. But most people don't know how these drugs actually work.
I will tell you, antibiotics, these little warriors pack a punch. They mess with bacteria in many different ways. For example, antibiotics can break down bacteria's cell wall or block their ability to copy DNA. They were mass-produced just in time to save thousands of soldiers during World War II and have since saved millions across the world. But from the start, there was a problem.
When Alexander Fleming discovered penicillin, the first broadly effective antibiotic, he noticed that microbes could easily become resistant to penicillin.
And here's how. Similar to human cells, bacterial cells also undergo random changes or mutations in their DNA. And if those mutated genes help the bacterial cell survive, it'll get passed on from parent to offspring throughout future generations.
Over time, these changes can result in mechanisms that help the bacteria fight off antibiotics. For example, some bacteria make special enzymes that inactivate antibiotics.
This evolutionary process is natural and constant in the microbial world, but the misuse and overuse of antibiotics in both humans and animals is making things much worse.
When antibiotics are used incorrectly, at the wrong dose, for the wrong disease, or for too little time, some bacteria are not killed and can pass on survival traits to their offspring. They try and teach them how to live even longer. And the more we overuse antibiotics, the more chances resistant bacteria have to survive, replicate, and outgrow non-resistant bacteria.
We've been talking about vertical gene transfer, where bacteria reproduce asexually, but multiple bacteria from different species can actually get together and swap out portions of their DNA.
Now, bacteria getting freaky with each other, or horizontal gene transfer, plays a big part in speeding up antibiotic resistance and creating superbugs. Superbug infections mean doctors have to treat patients with many rounds of powerful and toxic drugs.
And sometimes, these last resort treatments don't work. Hospitals already use a lot of antibiotics and are filled with sick people, so they can become epicenters of superbug outbreaks. Each year, 90,000 people die from hospital-associated infections, and even more have prolonged, dangerous hospital stays. The World Health Organization monitors these multi-drug-resistant pathogenic threats, and at the top of its global priority list is Acinetobacter baumannii. This microscopic supervillain nearly killed our next guest, Dr. Tom Patterson.
But that microbe was up against the fiercest possible foe, UCSD epidemiologist Dr. Steffanie Strathy, who just so happens to be Tom's wife.
Well, my husband and I have a habit of traveling together. We went to Egypt. He and I had this wonderful dinner on top of a cruise ship. on the Nile in Luxor, Egypt. And then he woke up in the middle of the night with terrible stomach pain. He was feeling worse in the morning. He couldn't keep anything down. The top GI doctor there, a couple of days later, he came back to me and said, this is actually the worst news we could have had. He's got Acinetobacter baumannii. Out of 15 antibiotics, it was only sensitive to 2. When I figured out that Tom was dying a little bit each day, I decided to have a talk with him. So I said, honey, if you want to live, please give me a sign, squeeze my hand, and I'll leave no stone unturned. But then all of a sudden he squeezed my hand and he squeezed it hard, and I fist pumped in the air. I was so excited, and then I thought, what am I going to do now? You know, I'm not like Superwoman. So I went home, I stuck the words multidrug-resistant Acinetobacter baumannii into that search engine and alternative therapies, and I came up with this paper, and I thought, I remember what phages are.
Bacteriophages, the little-known microbial hero of this story, are viruses that have evolved to target and kill bacteria. Now, thousands of varieties exist, each evolving over time to infect either one bacteria or several different types.
Phages are more populous than every other organism on Earth combined. They can be found any place where there are bacteria, even your own microbiome. But don't worry, they can't infect human cells.
In the early 1900s, prior to the antibiotic era, scientists were actually interested in the therapeutic potential of phages to fight bacterial infections. But with the primitive understanding of how these viruses worked, insufficient clinical tools to actually formulate the treatments, and then the advent of antibiotics, bacteriophage therapy was basically pushed aside for decades.
But that would change with Tom, who was the first documented case in the US to use intravenous phages to eradicate a systemic bacterial infection. Dr. Strathdy wrote to all the phage researchers she could find to identify phages that would target Acinetobacter baumannii. With persistence and luck, she found a match.
We injected the phages first into the catheters in his abdomen, and 3 days later, Tom woke up.
Bacteriophage therapy is just one in an arsenal of tools that researchers are developing to prepare for the threat of antibiotic resistance. And it's important to note, phages can overcome some of the challenges that antibiotics run into. For one, phages have very specific bacterial targets, so they don't go after the body's beneficial bacteria when administered.
But there are some big drawbacks. Since phages have a narrow spectrum, doctors will need to know the exact bacterial strain causing an infection, and will need to have several phages on hand that target that strain. This means that each patient will need a customized therapeutic phage cocktail, which is no easy task, and research institutions will definitely need to expand their library of known phages.
I know what you're probably thinking. Won't bacteria develop resistance to this treatment? The risk of bacterial resistance to phages is low. That's because there's an almost endless supply of phages in nature. So researchers can always search for new phages that bacteria haven't yet outsmarted.
After Tom's successful treatment with phage therapy, the door was now wide open for experimentation.
Dr. Strathdy founded the first dedicated phage therapy program in the U.S. at UC San Diego. They've successfully treated 7 more patients with multidrug-resistant infections.
And the world's been watching. In October, the NIH greenlit a clinical trial at UCSD to see if phages could successfully treat patients with cystic fibrosis who have recurrent infections.
But phages alone aren't gonna cut it. Remember, we're in a race against time with an enormous human toll. Bacteria have been shown to begin developing resistance traits just 10 days after introduction to a new antibiotic.
Some biologists are looking for natural or synthetic compounds that target bacteria in new ways. AMPs, or antimicrobial peptides, are a top candidate.
These small proteins made by all living organisms are the first line of defense against a much broader spectrum of microbes than phages.
And there's another class of compounds that can throw a wrench into bacteria's defense system.
Efflux pump inhibitors are important, and what they do is they lock up the efflux pump. So all cells have efflux pumps, so they're primitive. What the efflux pumps do, and they evolved to do probably billions of years ago, is capture those weapons that other bacteria were throwing at a given bacteria and pump them out. Bacteria or single cell organisms were fighting each other with what we now use as antimicrobials. And so what we're doing and what other labs are doing too is trying to find molecules and then develop them that prevent those pump mechanisms from pumping out antibiotics.
Now, Corrie, in terms of treating resistant bacterial infections, we've heard about these alternatives to antibiotics. Which therapies do you think are the most promising? And when will we actually see them used in hospitals?
For AMPs, efflux pump modulators, and phage therapy, I would argue we're all at the very early stages for all of them. And the goal needs to be at this point, just trying to develop all of them and seeing which ones work under which circumstances. I think efflux pump modulators are particularly promising because what they do is they work with our existing clinical antibiotics.
Outside of the lab, there are effective actions we can all take to fight antibiotic resistance. First up, and this one is huge, you have the power, yes you, to prevent bacterial infections in the first place. Wash those hands, prepare food safely, use condoms to prevent STDs. The fewer opportunities we give bacteria to evolve, the better.
Next up, use antibiotics appropriately, please. This is called antibiotic stewardship. It's something that we can all do, patients and healthcare professionals. Don't use antibiotics prophylactically or to treat viruses. Always talk to a doctor if you think you have an infection and need antibiotics. So, Sheena, healthcare professional to healthcare professional question. How often do you see or hear about antibiotics being used inappropriately?
Well, I'd like to just, approach this a little bit differently. One thing that I feel like is the issue is our societal norms as far as like workplace culture. A lot of the reasons why we're so in a rush to get antibiotics when we have viruses is because the culture is not so that it makes it easy for us to call out of work. And let alone call out because your child is sick. So a lot of times we're rushing viruses to be over so that we can feel better. When truth be told, the remedies are staying in bed, staying away from people, some hot tea, a humidifier. What do you think?
I will tell you, in kids, hospitalized children, the overwhelming majority of basic colds are caused by viruses. Even if they're nasty, even if kids look sick, have fevers, it's still a virus. But for some reason, we have this ingrained in our culture that if your kid is sick, you gotta run for an antibiotic. So I often hear about these stories of people not only getting antibiotics inappropriately prescribed, but sometimes people share antibiotics.
Yeah, Alok, but the problem is try telling someone that when they feel terrible and they're in the hospital feeling like they can't breathe. So it's tough when you know that the virus won't have any change due to an antibiotic, but at the same time, sometimes they develop into COVID pneumonia and now we're giving them antibiotics and the patient's family member is like, oh, so now you wanna show up.
But what people out there watching need to know is that these are very drawn out conversations that we're having with patients, with families, with other experts, with our nursing staff, with our pharmacy staff. Like, we're being very diligent in these conversations. We're not just throwing things to the wind. That's why if anyone out there is like, hey, I think I need an antibiotic, because my cold, or what I thought was a cold, is not getting any better, you have to go and talk to a healthcare professional.
That does it for this week's episode of PBS Vitals. Has antibiotic resistance got you worried? Have you had any brushes with resistant infections? Tell us what you think in the comments. Hit the like button, follow along on our socials, and we'll see you next time.